I'm Lenny Henry, and I'm here to perform in a special hometown concert for people just like me. You know, every week for the past 15 years, I've caught the train back home, back to my roots, because, you know, deep down in the end, I'm just an ordinary guy.
Certainly. Your ticket, please.
Sorry?
Let me see your ticket, please. Your ticket, you just come off the train. Where's your ticket?
Excuse me, what's your name?
My name?
Yeah.
John Cooper, what do you want that for?
Could you just hold for a second, John? Hi, Vanessa. Yeah, look, apparently you need something called a ticket to get off the train. Well, search me.
Your ticket, your little cardboard thing you buy before you get on the...
Could you... Yeah, well, I don't know. Well, I'll ask him. Yo, Jono, what are you asking for this ticket?
Single.
No, married.
London, Birmingham, at 2750.
Okay. Vanessa, could you send a check for 2750, please, to Jack Cooper at Birmingham Trainport? Jack heads up the ticket division down here. Uh-huh. I'll ask him. Yo, Jack, what's your fax number down here?
Haven't you got any money on you?
Hang on a second, I'll ask. Haven't I got any money on me? Where is it? Hang on, I'll check. Oh, Vanessa, you're a genius. Look at this mega one. Put it up, goodbye. Sorry about that, JJ. So, what was it again?
2750.
2750, okay, good. So, what about this? Will this do it?
Well, I've been away for a great long time. Coming back home just to switch off my mind. Yes, I'm coming home someday. Our trouble will be over, we'll do just like
me. Here I am in the Midlands where everyone knows who I am.
Please.
Yes, I am.
Brilliant. Can you get me John French's autograph?
How can they do that? How can they do that to me? That was my primary school. Do you understand what I'm saying, people? They knocked down my primary school and put up a bloody car park. Well, they kind of knocked this place down. This is Mortimer Street, right round the corner from where I was born. And at the end of this street is Tesco's, but not just any old Tesco's. This is the Tesco's that gave me my first summer job stacking shelves when I was 12 years old, so... Where the bloody hell is it then? I know. It's the other side of the street. Bastards, they've done it again! They've knocked down Tesco's and put up a church! Every Saturday afternoon in the mid-70s, me and my mates would trawl all the shops in Birmingham looking for the biggest pair of flares we could find. And hey, look at these Oxford bags. We're talking car park size. And then back to the house, quick wash and brought up with plenty of brute. And then put your dancing shoes on and down that disco. Yeah!
Excuse me, are you Lenny Henry?
Yes, I am.
I think you're great. Oh. I'm a big fan of yours.
Thank you very much. That's great.
As a matter of fact, I've got some very early film of you.
You're joking. Well, that's what this is all about. This is a memory lane kind of thing, right, guys?
Well, come along and have a look at it. I live just around the corner.
Okay. Okay, great, great.
Yes. Ah, here we are. Yes. 1974. I took this myself.
Oh, I hope it's not too embarrassing.
I spotted you very early, young man, and I've been following you ever since. Yes. I used to work at Denham's.
Oh, the big store.
That's right, yes.
Ladies and gentlemen, Lenny Henry!
Thank you very much. Thank you very much indeed. What a fabulous audience. You're so brilliant. You're a very delightful audience. I wanna take you all home because I'm trying to sell my house. So, no, I'm really, really pleased to be here. And there's just something about Midlands audiences. And I'm not just saying this because I was born around here and I'm from here, you know, but Midland audiences are quite ugly. So, I mean, just... I'm just kidding. So you, the elephant man, what's your, pardon? Murray?
Barry.
Mary?
Barry.
Barry? Oh. There was no consonant there, Barry. You kind of, Mary. Oh, it is. And what do you do? You're an engine fitter at Rolls Royce. How fabulous. What do you drive? You drive a stag? What, so you just hold onto the antlers and go like this? Fantastic. I mean, you don't need a Rolls Royce for that, just plenty of hay and broom, off you go. And somewhere to hang your hat when you get to work, Barry. Let's just talk to the people in the really duff seats. Black people, woolly, but black people come to this show tonight. Nice to see you. How you doing, man? Nice to see you.
Jesus Christ.
Oh. No, it's cool. It's cool. See, just, you know, enjoying yourself. It's brilliant. So, my man, are you in show business then? Well, get your foot off my stage, guy, because... Honestly. I'm just kidding. Oh, it's such an old one. Old but appreciated, I would have said. So what about you, boy? And the guy here with the... It's nearly a beard, isn't it? It's kind of... It's like straight dental floss to me, but it's... Look at this, Jesus. How are you? It's nice to meet a man with tattoos that are spelt correctly. Anyway, I'm going to talk to this bald guy here, but I won't draw attention to it. Oh, yeah, my friend. Look like one buttock just sticking up from the front row. Just a solo buttock on its own. Oh, it's a... No, it's nice to meet you. What's your name?
Paul.
And what do you do?
Engineer.
You're an engineer, great. I love the way guys sit when they come to the theatre. They sit with their legs akimbo. All these guys down the front, they're all sitting with their legs like this. It's like they've smuggled their friends in to watch the show. In their pants for nothing. Watching through the flies. This is a brilliant show, this is. Shut up! There's some girls here with big hair. That's a bike pump job, isn't it? God almighty, I bet you need a sunroof to drive here, don't you? Just, you can poke your hairdo through. Hello. What's your name?
Katrina.
Katrina, wow, great. Can I try your glasses on, Katrina? Thank you very much. No, okay, can I? Because I'm interested in this. I'm always like... Bloody hell! My welcome to your world, Katrina. This is amazing. My God, Katrina, no wonder you moved back when I moved towards you. Must have been like, aah. This is like being Marge Proops on crack. It's like, yes, concerned of Coventry, your bollocks should be rectangular. It's like, my God. Katrina, I'm gonna give you these back because you need them, man. There, I'm back, see? Because I can see you laughing, but you're going, Lynn? See, everything has edges now, Katrina. Well, thanks very much for coming. You guys are ugly, but at least you're on time. I was 2 hours late today. I don't care. It's my show, I come when I like. Strolling. I'm the late guy, that's me. I arrive 2 days late for meetings. I walk in like this. Because I don't care, man. I think you've got to be late and go straight in. Don't wait for stuff. I read somewhere that we spend 4.5 years of our lives just queuing up for stuff. 4.5 years? You could be having sex. They could put little booths at bus stops. That'd be good, wouldn't it, eh? The bus had arrived. Could you go around again, pal? Don't be on time for anything. Arrive late, then go straight in. For instance, right, I went to see Aspects of Love the other night. It was brilliant. I was 2 hours late, missed the whole thing. I'm going to miss it again tomorrow. It's the kind of show you can miss again and again. Just be late for everything. See, we're so hung up on punctuality in this country. You know, places like Jamaica, the whole country's late. Ever flown to Jamaica? Kingston Air Traffic Control is an answering machine. We can't come to the airport right now. Everybody is at the beach. Please land your airplane. After the beep. And Mandela was an hour late coming out of prison. See, everybody's late. Mandela was an hour late and it was on TV in this country and people complained because it screwed up a whole evening's viewing. I couldn't believe it. It was on Points of View the next week. People were there, dear BBC, why, oh, why, oh, why was the Antiques Roadshow cancelled for the release of this ex-convict? Yours, disappointed of Downing Street. I mean, there's just no place in something. And I was really chuffed to be on Mandela Day. It was great. Mandela Day was great. I got to meet all the stars backstage. I was hobnobbing, you know. Introducing them to each other. Sting, fish, this is Bono. Bono, you know, the Edge, salt, pepper, meatloaf. Why don't you guys club together and buy yourself a decent frigging surname? What's the next generation of rock stars gonna be called? And now, will you please welcome the mighty Buh! It's ridiculous. I got to meet Patti LaBelle, man. She walked in, she looked great. She had on this white floor-length fur coat. Looked like a dead polar bear on her back, like. She was trying to justify it to Chrissy Hynde, who's a rampant vegetarian. Listen, honey, it would never have got the chance to meet Nelson Mandela if it was alive. And I got to meet Mandela. I got to meet him. It was the greatest moment of my life. But why is it at moments like this, when it really matters, does your brain get the hell out of your body and leave your gob in charge? I shook hands with Mandela. He smiled at me. I was awestruck, man. I wanted to say something intelligent like, you are the light that will guide your people out of the darkness. What actually came out was... He must have walked away going, who was that dickhead? Blew my big chance, man. But I love the music. I'm a big fan of music. I love classical music. Schubert, Shostakovich, Brahms, Beethoven. It's very spiritual to me. I always buy the CD. Take it home, unwrap it, sit back in my favorite chair. And then I put a James Brown album on because it's bloody annoying, isn't it, classical music? It's bloody poncy, isn't it, classical music? James Brown doesn't need some pillock with a stick and a bow tie telling him when to sing, does he? I'd love to see that gig. I really like pop music, which is why I get so pissed off when I watch Top of the Pops on a Thursday night. Because there's some pap around at the moment, isn't there? Isn't it crap at the moment? I want to get Sonia and go like this. Thank you. Ooh, yes. Went to see Madonna, Wembley Stadium. What a great concert, man. She came on at the beginning and it was broadcast live on the radio and she swore 13 times in the first 90 seconds. I bet that was a surprise for the people who tune in for Gardener's Question Time.
Let's not ask her about the begonias, dear. She sounds a bit cross.
And what a show. She humped the bed and she fiddled with her fiddly bits and a big cross came down out of the sky and suddenly we're in church. She's bonkers. Imagine Madonna as a teenager. What was she like, huh? Madonna in confession. Bless me, Father, for I have sinned. I know that child. Now get your hand out of my pants. I mean, was it like that? Was it like that? What do you think? Well, and I like rap music a lot. I listen to it all the time. Pump up the jam, pump it up. While your feet are pumping and the jam is stomping, look to hear the crowd is pumping. Pump it up a little more. Get your booty swing on the dance floor. See, because that's... What are they talking about? I'm a black man. I don't know. The other one's Black Box. Remember that when they sampled that woman's voice, Lolita Holloway, and put it on the record, and it was a big hit last year? Number one for 7 weeks or something. Ah, how? Gotta get up. Gotta get up. You bloody would get up if that was your alarm call, wouldn't you? Imagine. Pace yourselves. Imagine. Imagine setting your radio alarm for 6 o'clock in the morning for work. 6 o'clock comes, you'd be like, be at work in 2 seconds, flat. Bollock naked, like. Funny, man. And the remixes are annoying now. The remixes, because the theory is you put some funky beats under something and it's a hit. Doesn't make it any better now, does it? I mean, they can do it with anything now. Ha! Yeah. Ha! Yeah. Ha! Yeah. Ha! Yeah. Ha! Who do you think you are kidding, Mr. Hitler? Bollocks, I don't go for it. Don't buy that shit. All the rock and roll skeletons are coming out of the cupboard. I was going to go see the Stones. But Keith cut his finger, so he couldn't play the guitar, so they cancelled the gig. Oh, because Keith cut his little finger. He cut his little finger, so he couldn't play the gig. I'm sorry, this is a man who shot enough smack into his body to make an elephant go, hey! I'm one of the few people who bought Keith Richards' solo album, I Know Pain. Because he can play guitar, but the man can't sing. I'll put it on, it came on. The dog from over the road knocked on the door and said, Len, take it off, please. I'm a dog, I know he can't sing. Boy. Thank God for Prince, that's all I can say. Because if Prince wasn't around, we'd have to live with all that stuff. Prince is my hero, you know, because he's so sexy. He is. I mean, I talked about this before, but the man is pure. He is the king of sex. I mean, Prince is a penis in heels. He is. I mean, who is? Let's face it, this is a man who knows how to shag a microphone stand. He does. He does it. And you know that after a gig, he goes back to his hotel room and waiting for him on the bed, 6 naked microphone stands. One day he's gonna get a big surprise, a big black amplifier is gonna walk in and say, I told you to leave my daughters alone. Thank you very much. Time for a holiday soon, I can feel it, you know. Just get a bit tense sometimes, you know, just a bit. tense. You know how you feel when you need a holiday, you know? You go in the shop and there's a young kid there with pimples and stuff and they take a bit too long giving you your change and you start to back like that. Walk out the shop, you know, walking behind the old people down the street and they're just doddering like this and going, and then walk around them and then, you know, it's time you had a holiday, really, you know. Is it too tense? And when I go on holiday, I like a nice hotel. I don't want 4 minutes walk from the beach. I want open the door, beach! Open the window, beach! Fall out of bed, beach! I don't want to walk. If I wanted to walk, I'd have bought a larder. I'm serious. And when I hit the beach, it stays hit. Just lie there and take my time. And then I go in the water. Eventually, I do go in the water eventually. And I just take my time. Check all around me, make sure there's one lifeguard per person. Make sure there's no little kids splashing around the way they do. You know, piss off, kid. Don't play with that shark. Don't you... And then I go in 3 inches an hour, just in case it's cold. Because guys can't go straight into the water, especially guys, forget that. Guys have to take their time. Women just run straight in the sea, don't they? Guys are like there, you know, 4 o'clock in the morning going, well. Still looks a bit cold. And then I do go in right up to my chest and I always check and look around, make sure those guys aren't snorkeling around, you know, the way they do. Zipping around, being interested in everything that's under the water, you know. Ooh, look, coral. Those are my testicles, actually, could you? The only place I can really relax is Jamaica. Because you get off the plane and you just, oh. You calm right down. Everybody's so cool and laid back in Jamaica. People have arguments, you know. Look what you did to me, Kiara. Yeah, you're right. Come and have a drink because there's no fuss in Jamaica. Everybody's just cool and, you know, easy and just nice. And I thought, well, because they're so cool, what do they do when they want to have a break from all of that, you know? I suppose they ring the travel agents and say, I want to go somewhere where there's plenty of tension. I need some angst and hassle and stress, you know? No, I did the Gaza Strip last year. Beirut is the place for me. It's true, you watch the news, there's always two Jamaican guys in the background ducking bullets and going, yeah. I feel really uptight, you know? Go and stand by that tank, blows and skirt, this is a good holiday. Last time I went to Jamaica was with another couple. And, the guy in the couple, Brian, was the whitest person I've ever seen in my life. Brian was so white, albinos were walking up to him in the street saying, you need to get a little sun. That's how white Brian was. We were on holiday the second day, hanging out, big baggy shorts, having a great time. Brian walks up to me, you know, and he says, hey, Len, you got any staff? I'm going, what stuff? Isn't that where you keep in the attic, you know? Stuff, what are you talking about stuff? He's like, oh, you know, come on, you know, stuff. Ganja. This guy's making assumptions about me because I'm a black man, you know. And I look at him, I said, look, Brian, I don't do drugs. He says, oh, come on. You can't go to Jamaica, it's a national dish, you gotta try ganja. If you don't come to Jamaica and try ganja, let's start going to America and not having a beef burger. That's like going to England and not having down a kebab, you know? I mean, I said, well, why have I got a... I haven't got any. He said, well, buy some for me. I said, what am I buying? I can't buy stuff for you. He says, I'll go on, Lynn. I look like a milk bottle. If I go and buy ganja, everybody will know what my game is, you know? So I didn't want to spoil the holiday, so I helped him, all right? I helped him. So, you know, I thought, well... Ganja. And bearing in mind that I am hip. I did the hippest thing I know. I thought, ganja, I looked in the Jamaican Yellow Pages under G. I was like... No good. Then I said, right, ganja, hit the streets, right? So I thought, these are my people, I can communicate with these guys, okay? So I'm walking up to people going, what am I right though? Look, and they're going, you is an English man, right? I go to another guy, I say, roots and culture and style and fashion and Bob Marley and the Wailers, Rastafari. He says, you is from Dudley, ain't it? So that's not good. Then I think, right, we sit down, me and Brian, and we go, right, where do drug dealers hang out? That's right, they hang around outside the school gates, don't they, the bastards? Right, let's go. So we go down to the local school, and I see this guy over there, you know, so I cross over the road, and I go and talk to him. I say, what? Yeah. He says, you is an English man? I said, yes, yes, I've done that one. I says, look, could I have a word with you for a second? He says, yeah, let's walk. I said, listen, you know, do you know where I can get some stuff? He says, stuff? What kind of stuff? Let's walk. I said, well, you know, stuff, marijuana, ganja, you know. He said, ganja? You want ganja? Let's walk. Have you ever tried to buy drugs from a lollipop man? It's impossible. So that was no good. He didn't know what I was talking about. So eventually we suss out that you can get it from the marketplace. So we go down the marketplace, and on the way there, I'm saying to Brian, you know, come on, Brian, we've seen Miami Vice. This is what you got to do if you want to buy drugs. You've got to be cool. You've got to look like you've done it before. You've got to look like you belong. We both walk into the marketplace like this. We might as well have had Where's the Ganja t-shirts on. Eventually, we're there lolloping around for hours. This bloke comes up and says, you want to buy some ganja? He says, shh, keep it down. Might be a policeman around. He says, I am a policeman. You want to buy some or not? So we follow this guy to his house, right, this policeman. And there it is on the kitchen table, this big shopping bag full of the stuff, you know. So, you know, I'm cool. I look at Brian. I get a leaf, I crumble it in my hand, I smell it, you know, and I look at the guy, I say, yeah, this is good. This is pure. He says, it may be pure, but it's cabbage. The real thing. The real thing is over here. Crazy English man. So we do the deal, you know. He says, how much you want? And I said, all of it. So we carry it back to the hotel in the pickup truck. Managed to get it up to the room, you know. Brian immediately lights this mega busting spliff, you know, whatever that is. And there's smoke everywhere. And being a passive smoker, I'm there going, oh, please, God, like this. And suddenly this old Jamaican cleaning lady just barges in the because they don't knock. Old Jamaican cleaning lady just barges into the room and looks at us accusingly and starts going like this. And I was so ashamed, you know. I thought, oh, God, what am I doing? What about if we've been nicked, you know? What's the matter with me, you know? This she looks just like my mum. And she looked at me, she said, why you buy that stuff? Eh? It's why you buy that stuff. Why didn't you buy it from me? It's much cheaper. Tourists, you always buy too much and leave it behind in the hotel room, so we just collect it up and sell it much cheaper. We're gonna sell our food downstairs. And it was true, which is why whenever there's a hotel fire, the whole town surround the building, like, make sure the fire brigade can't put it out, you know, move it. Yeah. The neighboring villagers there going, don't keep that building to yourself, you know. Pass the building on the left-hand side. Oh, great audience. It's great to be back in the Midlands. Every time I come here, you know, it's really weird because I'm coming down the M6, and as I get nearer to Birmingham, it's about Junction 5, my voice starts to go, ooh, turn it on to Beacon Radio. Because when you're in London, you adopt this kind of mock It's not cockney, but it's like, yeah, you know, you're on the phone, you talk to people, and it's very kind of, you know, you slip into this kind of jive kind of thing. You know, we get about halfway to the middle of by Fort Dunlop, I'm going, ooh, it's great around here, isn't it? Look at the chimbleys. And I go and see my mum, and it always reminds me of what it was like when I was little, you know. And basically, because mum and dad and everybody were out at work all day, it was my job to look after my younger brother, Paul. So all I heard all day was, what your mama is about this? Mama's gonna kill you when she hears about this. I'm gonna tell mama. That's all I heard all day, every day. Especially during the summer holidays. And I used to try and, you know, I'd look after him, but he was always walking like a few feet behind me while I was with my older friends, you know, trying to be hip, you know, talking about music and girls. Meanwhile, he's behind going, I'm gonna tell mama. Going to that mumbling, moaning, you know, that kids do. I'm gonna tell mama. With the two silver lines that are perpetually there. Remember when you used to cry and a balloon would come out of your nose? That was like, that's what my brother Paul was like. One day we took him to the swing park and I was with my older friends and Paul was there and I was talking to my older friends about girls and about, you know, whatever. And my brother Paul just walked in front of one of the swings just at the moment that one of my friends let go of a swing and it hit him right in the mouth. It was like my friend was doing an experiment. He said, oh, you never see that in the cartoons, do you? Cool, look, I thought it was gonna go through his head and come all the way back. You don't see that in the cartoons. Look at all the teeth on the floor. You never see that in the Flintstones, do you? Cool, look at her. Paul's going, thank you, aren't you? Your finger, yeah, you're gonna plug it off. I'm gonna tell mama about this. Mama gonna kill you when she hears about this. And when I got Paul home, I tried to sneak past my mum, but she was like, mum radar was out, you know. Len! What happened to Paul's teeth? I tried to think of something. They just fell out. We must have walked past a nuclear power plant or something. They just fell out. I was always getting into trouble for different stuff. One of the main things that I remember from my childhood was the fact that I was very inquisitive, about 9 years old, very, very inquisitive. And I was really interested in sex, you know, very, very, you know, always reading about it, wanting to know more, asking questions about it. And I nearly burnt the house down because of sex. Too noisy. I'm down in the cellar, I'm 9 years old. I'm scouring my brother Seymour's incredible collection of cheap and nasty paperbacks. I'm looking for dirty bits, but I'm not having much luck. Because they were all early 60s westerns with crap titles like Whip Off My Chap's Chimichonga, you know. The Man With Two Weapons, you know. There were no lights in the cellar because of my dad. My dad was a normal dad, you know, he'd work hard all day. And then he'd come home from work and walk into the living room where we were watching TV and he'd just switch over. Do all dads do this, or was it just... You just walk in like this, you know?
I want to watch the cricket. Stop bloody crying. I want to watch what I want to watch. Bloody Top Cat. By you on TV. Bloody Pixie and Dixie.
My dad, he never fixed the lights in the cellar, which is why I was down there reading in the near dark. So I improvised. I got an old milk bottle, filled it with paraffin. This is a true story. Put some old newspaper in the top and lit it. I called it a lamp. I think older, wiser people might have called it a Molotov cocktail. So I put my lamp on what I imagined to be a coffee table, but it's actually the corner of the crate where all the Tinder dry books were. I balance it on the corner, you know, safely. And I'm reading my book and I'm trying to get myself turned on, but I'm only 9, I don't know how, you know. Tweaking my elbows, rubbing my ankles, Suddenly, one of these involuntary spasms, which is the closest I got to an orgasm all afternoon, knocked my lamp or the incendiary device, as it can now be correctly called, into the crate of Tinder dry books and sent a 4-foot column of flame going past my nose. Fire. Every bloody where. I was a bright child. I knew this was an emergency. I ran upstairs, man. I got a saucepan, I filled it with water, ran back downstairs, threw the water. Only I've chosen one of those itsy-weensy saucepans that to boil a single bloody egg in. I threw the water, got about halfway there and went sss. I had the typical 9-year-old reaction. Oh, shit. I become a little uneasy. Mom's gonna kill me for this. What are we gonna do to Mama? Because Mom was a disciplinarian in our family. If I hit my sister Sharon, she went, bam! You mustn't hit people. If I fell off a high wall, she'd hit me out of compassion. What if you got hurt? So what's she gonna do when she finds out I burnt the house down, jerking me gherking? I'm in big bloody trouble. I decide to call the fire brigade. I run into the hallway. I forgot, we don't have a phone. The nearest phone box is a 5-minute run. I do the journey in 1 minute. I come back to the house. It's still on fire. The lino in the kitchen's bubbling. I decide to kill myself. I get a little plastic knife out of the knife drawer. A little plastic one, you know, a blunt one, you know, and I push it, well, not too hard, into... I didn't want to hurt myself, you know. If you ever cut yourself, it bloody hurts, that does. And I can't kill myself, what's God gonna say? So, whilst you were flogging your log, you, burnt your house down, and then you did yourself in. That's masturbation, arson, and suicide. Nice work, youngster. Going down. The fire brigade arrived, put the fire out. Mum's gonna be home any second. I'll try and get one of the firemen to adopt me, you know. No good, I think that actually puts them off and they leave really quickly. I decide to run over to the park, stay there for 9 hours, hoping a big Rottweiler would drag me away in its teeth, you know. Doesn't happen. Gets really dark. Decide to make the long journey home to face the music. I trudge home really slowly. You know how slow you walk when you're in trouble? Like. A tortoise with one leg overtakes me like... I get to the front door. Open it. No gunfire. I walk in the living room. Mum's there. I hit the fetal position. She says, Len, get up. You know how people have those out-of-body experiences? Well, right at that precise moment, I wanted one. She grabbed me, I went, oh, it's the Jamaican death grip. Oh, God. Well, it's okay, I've had 9 good years. You start logarithms at school next week, it's probably a good time to die. After a while, I realized there was no pain. She wasn't strangling me, she was just hugging me. She said, Len, go to your bed. That was it. She just let me go. She never punished me. She didn't hit me, she didn't touch me. I was walking to bed like this. Got into my bedroom, put on my pajamas, you know. Waited up for a few hours, waited for that little surprise. What about this fire? It never happened. She never touched me. I'm really, really grateful to her for that. You know, she taught me a great lesson. Spare the Rod and all that stuff. She set a great example for me, and we're very, very close. I love my mum. I know this is corny, but I love my mum very much now. And she's a cool person. She's dead nice. And she comes to visit us all the time. And last year she came to visit us just after we moved into our new house. Burnt the fucker to the ground. That was because of sex, you see. My first physical encounter with a member of the opposite sex, a girl, was at the Dudley Odeon. Back row, Saturday morning pictures, arm round, like, waiting for the lights to go down, smiling with anticipation, because I knew there were certain things you could do in the dark. At the pictures. It had been agreed by the government. You could go outside upstairs, outside downstairs, inside upstairs, and the big winner, inside downstairs along the corridor without a back on. I don't know what it meant either, but it sounded more exhausting than shagging, you know. So as not to upset your girlfriend, right, you had to make sure that all preliminary touching seemed like an accident. You know, so you had to plan it out. You had to plan out how you did it. So the lights went down. I went to the toilet. I came back. Accidentally on purpose tripped. Did a double somersault, then a backflip. Landed with my head in the girl's lap and my pants around my ankles. After an appropriate wait, 8 to 10 minutes, I said, oh God, I'm so clumsy, I'm really sorry. My date shouts from the back, I'll bet you are, that's not your row. You had to have so much courage, didn't you, to ask a girl out. I used to drink and drink and drink and drink and then do it, you know. Up until I was 22, I thought all girls swayed from side to side. Like... I used to go out with white girls. I didn't mind. I used to like going to their houses for supper with their parents. I like to arrive 20 minutes early and catch their parents peeling the labels off Cape apples. Like, oh shit. Then I walk in the living room and Zulu would be on the television. They'd switch it off really quickly. It's for grandfather, you know. Then I'd sit down at the dinner table and they'd talk to me like I was deaf, you know. So do you eat chicken then? This is what we call Yorkshire pudding. So what do you normally eat when you're at home? I always felt they'd be disappointed if I didn't say something like, witchetty grubs and bark and old mud. Bring me the virgin child now. So I had to spite with just snug on the carpet all night and fiddle around. And trouble is, if you're gonna do that stuff now, you gotta wear a Jimmy hat. I think you know what I'm talking about. I'm talking about, of course, the condom. The guys who annoy me are the ones who say, I don't like condoms, it's like having a Wellington boot on your willy. What I wanna know is, how does he know what that feels like? Must be murder on a date with him, you know. Hang on, love, just gonna put the willy on. Look at the tread on that. This will baffle Scotland Yard. The people who frighten me are the people who like their sex with a hint of pain. Just a whisper of a smack on the body with a machete. People down here nudging each other like, what's going on with these people? Hasn't anybody at one of these kinky sex parties ever said, that bloody hurt me, that dude? She's a maniac with that whip that woman is. The one over there in the studded knickers, she's horrible. Get away from me with that sheep prodder, pal.
I'm going home. I thought this was a chip shop.
People have always been obsessed with sex. Right back to biblical times, Adam and Eve. Adam was desperate. This is a man who took out one of his own ribs in order to eventually play hide the sausage. One of his own ribs. Imagine if he could do that today. Can't get a date for the weekend? Rip out a piece of chest. Of course, lonely, ugly guys that have trouble standing up after a while, they'll be like... I may not look too good, but at least I'm nubbing. But that's not real sex. That's not real cover me in peanut butter, pour Guinness off my head and lick it off sex. Oh no, Serene Mighty Bob. Real sex is when you first meet someone and it's passionate and glorious and it's exciting and you're never out of bed. It's like your genitals are made out of Velcro, you know. It's, I love you. I know. Let's go out for dinner tonight. Let's stay in and not. Shall I feed the cat? We'll get another one. And then after 7 years of marriage, it's like this. Is that you breathing? Well, stop, because it's pissing me off. See, it's difficult to sustain a relationship. It's difficult to keep it interesting. In the olden days, they used to preserve an element of mystery by having separate beds in different countries. See, what you got to learn is, and what I had to learn is, relationships are nothing like the films, all right? It's just not. I mean, in a film, like in the old days, Cary Grant or somebody would be doing the ironing, giving himself little burns, you know, and there'd always be some blonde babe who'd come out of the shadows and go, I'll do it. In reality, you could burn your bloody head off. Your wife's there going, you just have to learn, won't you? I want to see working couples portrayed realistically in the films at bedtime. Knackered zombies in search of cocoa. And the biggest share of the duvet. And if anybody mentions sex, the other one screams, do you know what time I got to get up in the morning? No, you put the bloody light out. I don't care how long it's been. And get that basil brush off and give it back to the kid next door. That won't work with me this time, matey. When I moved into a flat with my then-girlfriend for the first time, I realized very soon that I was terrible at everything around the house. Couldn't fix anything at all. I was useless. You know, the only thing I was good for was reaching for things. Say, so, get that pot down. I go, all right, then. Say, so, get that one down as well. All right, then. We'd have dinner parties. She'd show me off. Do that thing you do. I go, all right, then. See, I'm one of the guys, I can't do anything complicated. I don't think men can do complicated things, which is why we don't have multiple orgasms. If men were as sexually sensitive as women, if men had as many erogenous zones as women, we'd be walking around like this all day. Turn it off, turn it off. It's very difficult indeed. Nice though, in the end. Got some tips. Got some tips for those of you who are trying to keep it going. For the ladies, you know. The best time to ask a guy anything, to get a man to agree to anything, is before sex, during foreplay, when you're nibbling the lobe of his ear and stroking his back and working your way down. Ask him anything. He'll agree. Can we get some new central heating? Can we look at carpets the weekend? Yes, yes! Can we? Yes, yes, yes! Anything, yes! This guy's gonna be doing odd jobs until a week past his death. Just for the chance of a good shaggy. Why not? That's what I say. The worst time, ask a man to do anything The worst time to get any sense out of a man at all is after sex. Because men's brains just, for some reason, don't function after an orgasm. Something snaps, I don't know what it is. Try it, make love to a guy, then ask him a question. Did you go to the bank today? Hey, Dick. If you don't deal with those papers, we're gonna lose the house. Hey, Dick. When are you gonna take your share of the responsibility in this relationship? Can we do it again? Just after I've had this little sleep. Thank you. Thank you. I've had a nice show. I've enjoyed myself. You've heard about some of my likes and dislikes. I don't like racism very much. I'm not mad keen on the National Front. Because you don't know who they are, do you? You know. I mean, if you look out your window, right, and you see a guy on a horse in a white sheet with a pointy hat carrying a flaming cross, you can be pretty sure he's not the Avon lady. The National Front, they haven't got a uniform, so it could be anybody, the butcher, the baker, and it probably is. And I came into contact with these guys about 6 years ago. Something happened. One of the quality papers printed my address. Just in case I got amnesia and forgot where I lived, you know. Oh, thank you. My house. And me and Dawn came back. That's my wife. My wife and I came back from something, some big thing. And I put my key in the lock and I looked up and I saw NF smeared on my front door in human excrement. Don't ask me how I knew. It was probably instinct. That and the 400 flies buzzing around my door knocker, you know. But they hate flies. And they pushed it through the letterbox as well. And I'd had correspondence from these people before, except not as gooey. And it was before I got married. They sent a letter to one of my gigs. And there were loads of insults in it about interbreeding. I think they were pissed off because I'm a man and Dawn's a woman. And there were loads of insults in this letter. They called me a coon. But they spelt it wrong. They spelt it with an O and an E. He said, you were nothing but a fucking cone, you know. I thought, wow, these guys are extremists, you know. Not only racial slurs, but geometric ones as well, you know. I imagined them writing it at home, you know, fucking triangles. You come over here with your two equal sides, stealing our women, taking our jobs. They're nearly as bad as the dodecahedrons, but at least they make a decent curry. So I'm standing on my doorstep, you know, upset. Not at the message, but at the method of leaving the message. I mean, if I come round to your house and you're not in, I'll write a note, slip it under the door. But these guys had to be that little bit extra. But I wanted to know the chain of events, you know. How do you plan something like this? I mean, is it, you know, do you crap at home and bring it with you? You know? Is it a spur of the moment thing? Are you bopping down the street with your pals? Do you suddenly say, hang on, Terry, forget about the spray paint. I got something else and it's free. And it was written right up there on my front door. How did he get it up there? They must have dropped his pants, picked him up and squeezed him like a human icing gun. Thank you very much. Good night.
If we're talking about showbiz roots, mine are right in here. You know, old programs never die. They just end up in the archives. 15 years ago, I was lucky enough to win a talent show called New Faces. I guess that's where it all really started for me. And I guess this is where I have to say goodbye. Roll it, Steve.
Here's my most recent poem that I wrote while I was waiting for Joe Booglet to hit me.
What the bloody hell's going on?
Sorry, Lenny. Looks like somebody's typed out on it, mate.
But that's terrible. It's a disgrace.
You're telling me you should have scored from there. Don't